Hello there. Welcome again to our sharing on the field of law, the favorite of many people, regardless of whether they have gone to law school or not. And today, we handle one of the most difficult subjects in the field of law, including the bar examination, where the number of those who passed is at the very minimum. Therefore, it would be very important for us to try to explain not only to our people in general who'd like to understand about taxation, specifically in this series, income taxation, and particularly gross income taxation. This is dedicated to all of you, my fellow countrymen, but in addition also to the candidates for the bar examination, as well as those who are taking the certified public accountants board examination under the Board of Accountancy. It is also dedicated to all the finance managers, tax lawyers, and everybody who's involved in any manner in taxation, most especially my friends in the Bureau of Internal Revenue, particularly the incumbent BIR commissioner and his deputies. A few days back, I was already updated uploaded a version of income taxation, specifically gross income. After version has been uploaded in YouTube, I noticed that I failed to adjust the volume of the input microphone so that the uploaded version in YouTube appears to have a very weak audio. And so I decided for purposes of making this more tolerable to those who will view it, I decided to take another couple of hours to upload this with the microphone adjusted. At the same time, I made sure that I went into the details of the train law to ensure that the amendments that were included there are also incorporated in this updated train version of gross income taxation. My attention was caught by a simple oversight that on the first introductory pages, I listed the income tax scenario to include not only the gross income, the deductions, but there was a third line which says exemptions. Under the train law, the personal and additional exemptions have been totally repealed and this no longer available. Although the details of our slides last time did not anymore include any discussion of exemptions. There was also a sincere effort to thoroughly review the maximum limits of each of the items under the Minimus Benefits to ensure that we do not over or understate the same. The allowable 13th month and other benefits was updated in the train law, and that was double-checked in all the parts of this uploaded one to show 90,000 per year. There was also an oversight in the 35% grossing up factor for fringe benefits because what was reflected in the initial upload was the old 32%. And so with all of these fine points, allow me therefore to run this version of gross income taxation under the train law. And just in case you might miss it, there is a little icon on the lower right portion of your screen that will allow me to earn the recognition of Google and YouTube by way of my contribution. So far, there is close to 500 subscribers, and there are much more than double that number who view this particular slides. So if you're one of those viewing these slides just for purposes of love and charity for yours truly, can you just click that subscribe button or icon? Not this one, but the one below your lower right-hand corner of the screen. To start the ball rolling, let me introduce myself for those of you who are viewing these YouTube uploads for the first time. I come from three different and complementary fields. My academic background is Bachelor of Business Administration and a Certified Public Accountant, Summa Cum Laude, University of the East. I hold a Master of Business Administration, University of the Philippines, Diliman, Magna Cum Laude, and Valedictorian. And my Bachelor of Laws, University of the East, Cum Laude, and Valedictorian. Immediately after I took the CPA board examination in the late 60s, I immediately joined the corporate business world. And for 45 long years, I have been involved on a graduated promotional basis in several industries that I would like to mention. I was with Fuji Xerox Philippines in the electronics printing and the Xerox machines as Executive Vice President, Chief Finance Officer, and Corporate Treasurer. I was also with the pharmaceutical industry, at the time SmithKline and French Overseas Companies, today merged with GlaxoSmithKline as its Director for Finance and Administration, and concurrently also handling market planning and development, including product management. For 13 years, I was with the electronics industry, particularly the semiconductor group under Motorola Philippines, where I was the finance manager. And I was also lucky to have experienced working with an integrated transport organization, both land transport, marine transport, air cargo, and warehousing, with Delgado Brothers Inc., initially as controller and later promoted after 1 year as Vice President Director for Financial Services. I started my career with an oil company, the number one oil company at that time, which was ESSO for Standard Oil of New Jersey, which later on became Petron. My career started as a financial analyst, and when I left Petron to become controller of Delgado Brothers, I was the most senior accounting supervisor handling inventory and cost accounting for Petron. In the field of business education, I have 35 years teaching stint in financial management with the De La Salle Graduate School of Business, and concurrently earlier, for 10 years, I was also a professor in financial management at the University of the Philippines Graduate School in Diliman. In the next field, which is my most beloved field, my childhood dream, is in the field of law. Personal circumstances allowed me to go back to law school when I was already 40 years old and already nursing a block, an aorta block in my heart, and was warned by my own cardiologist that I will die while I am in law school. That was so many years ago. I guess it's a lucky break for you and me to meet each other, because from my cardiologist's point of view, I have no reason to anymore exist today. And so, as I said, I took up my Bachelor of Laws, University of the East, graduating cum laude and valedictorian. And even when I was working full-time as finance manager of Motorola, I will take some leave to handle criminal, civil, and labor cases before the regional and metropolitan trial courts in Metro Manila, as well as the surrounding provinces, and also labor cases before the labor arbiter and the National Labor Relations Commission. Several of my cases went up to the Supreme Court and was lucky to have received favorable resolutions. In addition to being an active practicing lawyer, even today, I was also a bar reviewer and a law professor, not only at the University of Manila, but also at the University of the East, University of Santo Tomas, De La Salle University, the University of Perpetual Health, San Sebastian College, and Far Eastern University. It was at De La Salle with FEU where we started pioneering on the five-year MBA JD program for brilliant students. I was lucky to have been nominated as Associate Justice of the Supreme Court on two occasions in 2012 and 2016. And I am an incumbent professorial lecturer in criminal law and mercantile law with the Supreme Court's Training Academy, the Philippine Judicial Academy. I was appointed Dean of the College of Law, University of Manila in 2004. And I was also asked to handle the Colleges of Law as Executive Law Dean of the University of Perpetual Health at Las Piñas and Binyan. Today, I am the incumbent Dean again of the College of Law, University of Manila, its incumbent Vice President for Legal Affairs, and a member of the Board of Trustees. So these are the three fields where I'm coming from: in the field of academics, in the field of business management, and in the field of law. My sharing with you on taxation is heavily influenced by my 45 years as Chief Finance Officer of the leading corporations in the Philippines, both local and multinational. And without resorting to tax evasion, I've been able to save tremendous taxes for our corporations, even when I made sure that the multinational companies I was working with were paying correctly their taxes. And so, without much ado, let me emphasize that this series of slides considers the tax reform for acceleration or inclusion, otherwise abbreviated to read TRAIN, under Republic Act Number 10963, effective on January 1, 2018. The most important component of these slides that are highlighted is the elimination and repeal of the basic personal and additional exemption under the TRAIN law. Our income tax scenario that we will lay before you would include the concept of gross income, and that will be the focus of this specific upload. And we will schedule a subsequent upload on deductions. To start the ball rolling on gross income, we will take up now the concept of income, and then we will consider what are included in gross income for tax purposes and what are the exclusions from gross income also in income taxation. To start with, let's take a look at the concept of income. In the mid-20s, before the Second World War, the leading nations of the world, even before the Organization of the United Nations, convened in Montevideo, Uruguay, to evolve what has been known now to be the Montevideo Doctrine. This was triggered by the evolving political scenario in the world, where the colonizers were starting to allow their former colonies to assume autonomy and independence. And so the leading nations started asking themselves, when do we consider a former colony, now independent, to be a state? And with this nagging question, the convention in Montevideo came up with four components to comprise a state. They said, a group of people occupying a territory with an organized government and recognized as a sovereign aggregation brings about the existence of the state. And so this is where the concept of people, territory, government, and sovereignty to comprise the state came about. The Montevideo Conference in Uruguay in 1926 that evolved the Montevideo Doctrine. When we therefore say and recognize that a state has been formed with the presence of these four elements of people, territory, government, and sovereignty, automatically that state generates an inherent, a set of inherent powers. By the organization of the state, automatically it achieves or acquires certain inherent powers by reason of its very existence, represented by the acronym PET, P-E-T. And the P would represent the inherent police power of the state, followed by the inherent power of eminent domain, and finalized by the concept of taxation. So a sovereign state would possess police power, eminent domain, and taxation. As a matter of fact, because taxation is an inherent power, the traditional question on whether or not a state can raise taxes even before the adoption of a constitution and a set of laws governing taxation, the answer is affirmative, yes, because taxation is an inherent power even without the framework of law of a state. Taxation can already be implemented by the governing body of that particular state. We will have a separate complete slide on the philosophy and concept of taxation. But for purposes of understanding the real inherent practical concept of taxation, allow us to say that the advent of taxation allows the state to tax on privileges given to its people using those privileges as the basis or foundation to implement the enforced contribution for its people. The first sample of this one is when the state says, I am giving you the privilege, the liberty to use your property. And if you are using your land, your building, your machinery and equipment, they are real properties that I allow you to use. Therefore, the state says, I will use the value of those properties that you're using for purposes of imposing an enforced contribution that we shall call the real property tax. And so that is how real property tax came into being. It is the imposition of the tax on the privilege of people within the territory under the sovereignty of the governing body to collect taxes on the basis of the use of such properties. Government also said that I am giving you the privilege to buy. But the moment you exercise your privilege to buy, I will use the purchasing power or the purchase price of that particular commodity that you bought in order to collect taxes. So in effect, while it has been popularly called sales tax, in reality, it is a purchase tax because it is imposed on the consumer who buys or purchases the tax, and his purchase price becomes the basis of taxation. Today, we call it the value-added tax, emphasizing more on the mechanism on how the purchase tax or the sales tax, as they used to call it, is collected along the trade route. The third one is that government says, I am giving you the privilege not only to use property, but also to own property. No? So use property, I collect real property tax on you, but I also gave you the right prior to the use of your right and privilege to own the property. Now here is a consequent right and privilege I'm giving you. While you are the owner of that property, I am also giving you the privilege to give away that property. And you are at liberty to do that subject to restrictions under the civil code. And so if you would like to give to anybody your property in the exercise of a donation, we call it in law donation inter vivos because the donor, the giver, is still alive. No? The word inter vivos, vivos is life or alive, and inter within the life of the giver. And government says, sure, I will recognize your privilege to give away your property provided that the market value of that property you're giving away at the time of the gift will now be the basis of your contribution to government, which has become to be known as the donor's tax. Government also says that you may or may not want to wait for your debt in order to pass on the property. And it is possible that you determine how to give away the property by your preparation of your last will and testament. And so I will honor your wish under a last will and testament provided you follow certain restrictions on giving away the property, particularly the legitimate of your children. And so if you give away your property through your last will and testament, which we call testate succession, then we impose, the government says, on our enforced contribution to you by way of an estate tax. However, if you should die forgetting or omitting the preparation of your last will and testament, then your property will still be given because you can no longer take your property 6 feet under the ground. Then the operation of the civil law on intestate succession. Whatever it is, your privilege exercised by reason of the law, provision of law on giving away properties intestate, will now be the basis of imposing what is called now the estate tax. But the most interesting concept in taxation is what we are now about to discuss. Government says that in other totalitarian states, you are supposed to render service to your state, to your government. And in return, the government is obligated to give you the necessities for survival on the matter of food, shelter, and clothing. We are not under that totalitarian system, and under our democratic and republican system, every individual like you would have the privilege to work and the privilege to be paid out of the service you perform, including your option to get engaged in business of buy and sell and generate a spread or profits on which goes to you as your buildup of wealth. Your privilege to earn income is a privilege that may or may not necessarily be available to citizens and people in other political jurisdictions. However, because you're giving that privilege to earn and accumulate wealth, we will use that as a basis for imposing the enforced contribution of taxes. So, the earnings that you make becomes now the basis of our enforced contribution that has became popular as your income tax. And so that is the essence of income taxation. As a matter of fact, there is even a more beautiful school of thought that when you are exercising the privilege to earn income, either as an employee, as a professional, or as a businessman, government says that you cannot perform any of those functions to earn your income without the active participation of government. Government provides you with the roads and bridges and the infrastructure so you can travel from your residence to your place of work and vice versa, for your business to pick up your goods from your factory to the location of your customers. So you need government to intervene. You need government to man the traffic. You need government to support the healthcare of everybody. And so in the process, government is a partner in your exercise of earning your income. And so when you earn your gross income, government says, I have a portion of that belongs to me. And therefore, since it belongs to me, you better turn over that portion that belongs to me as part of your contribution, which we call now your income tax. This is a very beautiful concept in that income tax is not technically an imposition ipso facto. It is essentially your agreement with your sovereign power, your government, that I will support, you know, the expenses of government. And because you render service to me, if I earn income, a portion of my income belongs to you, which I cannot spend. And so, in effect, if I spend that, then I go into what is called tax evasion, and I can therefore be prosecuted parallel to the principle of fraud or staffa. And so, we develop a certain set of penal laws in order to punish anybody who does not turn over the share of government in earnings. Ang ganda po talaga ng concept under that. Moving now, therefore, to the very issue of what exactly do we mean by income, which is the one that is being taxed in income tax. Let us now take a look at some of the fundamental concepts. The concept of income can be equated to money. And so any money coming to a person as payment to him for services he performed, or as interest in the form of rental on the money that he lent out, no? Borrowed money from him, or the profit that he what they call this derives out of buying cheap and selling more. Buying cheap and selling more. So the difference between his selling price and his purchase price becomes his profit or spread, as we call it in business. And this would be in the concept, therefore, of income. Another way to look at income is that it is any wealth, kahit anong kayamanan, that flows into the taxpayer. And so essentially, this wealth would be denominated by way of money. And so if money, which comprises wealth as you try to save them and accumulate it, is income, provided it is not a return of capital. So if you already earned income, which was already taxed, and you earned income in the subsequent year that you merge with your year one income, and that year one income you decided to lend, and you get interest income out of it, the repayment of the interest is income. But the repayment of your income on the first year that becomes your capital or principal for the second year in lending out, the return of that principal is no longer income because it is simply a return of what was already previously taxed. The third one, which becomes an all-encompassing one, says that income would represent all income derived from whatever source. And so that resolves essentially the principle that every flow of money that goes to an individual, unless it is a return of capital, is income, and so therefore subject to the enforced contribution called income tax. After understanding the fundamental concept of income, let us now go into the more specific details of what are included for tax purposes in gross income. So the inclusions to gross income would be two major types of income. The first one is active income, and the second one is passive income. Active income, passive income. How do we distinguish the two? In active income, these are incomes or monies earned through the actual, direct, and personal effort of the taxpayer, made physically, mentally, or both, whether or not with the assistance of financial or equivalent resources. The most important thing here to visualize is there is money coming in, and the money coming in is because an individual exercised a certain kind of effort, a certain kind of service that is actual. And second, it is direct. And third, it is personal. So siya yun, actual, ginawa niya, direct siya mismo gumawa, at personal, siya mismo ang tao na gumawa. And whether it is involving his physical resources or his mental or a combination of both, that would be the categorization of what's called active income for any money that is given to him. On the other hand, in the concept of passive income would be those types of income, monies flowing into the taxpayer, no, using the taxpayer's cash, properties, and or other financially valuable resources without the actual, direct, and personal effort of the taxpayer. So let us be very clear on that. In active income, it is the person himself that exercises the effort, mentally or physically. In passive income, he has properties in the form of his savings in cash, properties that he purchased, or other financially valuable resources that he says, "Hey guys, you are my soldiers, my financial soldiers. Go to battle and render service, because out of your rendering service, you will be paid." And under the principle of civil law in the civil code, since I am the owner of that cash, I am the owner of those properties and resources, the fruits of those properties belong to me. And that is what comprises passive incomes. So we have our natural fruits out of our property. We have our civil fruits and we have our industrial fruits. Okay. And so all of this arising from the use of our cash, properties, and other valuable resources as considered as income, and they belong to passive income because it is these properties that generate the revenue arising from performing a function or service other than the actual direct and personal effort of the taxpayer. In the area of active income, there are three activities that may bring about active income. The first one is under an employer-employee relationship, where an individual exerts his actual direct and personal effort by working with an employer, dedicating his physical or mental or both physical and mental capabilities to service the need of the employer in particular needs that the employer would need. And so therefore, under an employer-employee relationship, that particular employee using his actual direct and personal effort to service the employer is given compensation for such under the principle that no person shall be unjustly enriched at the expense of another. Nagtatrabaho siya para sa employer, nakikinabang yung employer, and under the principle that no unjust enrichment, the employer should pay. The employer should compensate that particular employee for the effort so exerted. And so, that employee now, out of his actual direct and personal effort, earns active income under the first module. The second module is those that are earning their incomes as professionals or those that are skilled and therefore are engaged in a certain type of trade. And finally, I just clicked the thing so fast that we need to go back to that particular slide. And say we said, another slide. And so we said here that the three modules by which active income can be earned would be under the employer-employee relationship, profession or trade, and finally, when a particular person engages in business of buying, selling. Buying, selling, he buys cheap, looks for somebody who is willing to pay at a higher price. So this the increase between buying price and selling price becomes now the income called profit to the particular business man. And so now, moving further, we now say, let's take a look at how the dynamics of an employer-employee relationship brings about active income. As what we were saying, when an employee performs actual direct and personal service to his employer, he gets to be compensated by way of salaries, wages, and other compensation. And so you may wonder, is there any difference between salaries and wages? The answer is simply nomenclature. Salaries would represent base compensation for services rendered by regular and probationary monthly paid employees. So ito yung mga monthlies, whether managerial, supervisory, or rank and file, usually paid every 15 or 30th. So monthly sila, therefore the month is divided to 15th and 30th. Their base pay is called salaries. What about the wages? When do we call the compensation wages? Wages would represent the base compensation for services rendered by daily or hourly rated employees, mostly regular or contractual rank and file workers paid usually on a weekly basis. But in addition to what are called basic salary and wages, the employee may be receiving additional cash, additional payments in kind, which has been called in collective concept fringe benefits. And so fringe benefits would represent any goods, service, or other benefit furnished by an employer to an employee, granted in cash or in kind, in addition to the basic salaries. And the principle, and let us emphasize this, that is why it is in red, any kind of cash or in kind received by an employee from his employer is considered part of taxable gross compensation income. This is the general rule, and unless the law provides an exception, all monies that are flowing to the employee arising from his employer-employee contract with his employer would constitute taxable active income. However, government recognized that there are certain fringe benefits where it will no longer tax the employee, and they now come in three components. The first is what is called the minimus benefits. The second one is benefits received under employer convenience rule. And the third one is what is called the fringe benefits tax. We will go over these three categories of fringe benefits that are not subject to tax anymore by reason of a legal enactment. Let's take a look at de minimis, and I would like to emphasize that particular word, mini. And we know mini is small. So let's take a look. Before we go into the details of tax-free de minimis benefits, let us broaden our understanding on the types of fringe benefits that an employee may be receiving from his employer. For instance, leaves with pay. And this will include vacation leave, sick leave, emergency leave, and maternity and paternity leaves. At this point, it is very important for us to refresh our mind on the labor principle of no work, no pay. No work, no pay, hindi ka pumasok, hindi ka nagtrabaho, therefore, walang obligasyon na bayaran ka. Again, under the principle of no unjust enrichment. Kung ikaw nagtrabaho, babayaran ka in order to ensure there is no unjust enrichment. Is it also true as a principle? Hindi ka nagtrabaho, hindi ka rin babayaran. Okay? However, as an exception, there are certain situations where the employee did not work. He was somewhere else but not in the company rendering service. And yet the company, you know, pays him by way of leaves with pay. So he's on vacation. He's at home. He's resting. You know, he's somewhere else. He is not in the office. And yet his company, his employer says, I will pay you even for the days that you are not working. Call that vacation leave. Same is true with sick leave. He's not in the office, he's not working, he's at home or he's in the hospital, not trying to get cured. So he is on sick leave, so the employer says, I will pay you even if you are not working and you are on sick leave at home or in the hospital. Same is can be said of emergency leave and maternity and paternity leaves. The employee can also receive from the employer medical benefits such as medical and physical examination, field health benefits that will allow him to be hospitalized, where his expenses will be covered, and free medicines and hospitalization. The employee may also be receiving additional financial compensation and assistance by way of subsistence allowance by way of free meals and snacks, by way of rice subsidy, overtime pay with premium, night differential pay, and hazard pay. All of these are given to the employee by the employer. The employee may also be receiving accommodations and conveniences such as free housing and free board and lodging, use of company cars under a company car plan or free transportation, travel, representation and entertainment, life insurance, household personnel, maids, cooks, drivers and gardeners, and membership dues on adjoining associations. Continuing with the types of fringe benefits, there can be the employee may be receiving other financial benefits such as it can borrow money from the company on company loans and cash advances. While it may be asked to pay interest, the interest may not be at market. It may be at a rate much lower than market. There are certain employees that can borrow money from their employers without having to pay any interest. And the fringe benefits tax would represent the taxes that managerial and supervisory employees are to pay because they are receiving some fringe benefits. But the company says, I will also pay for the tax on the benefit that you receive. That's a fringe benefits tax that we'll explain in a little while. The employee may also get other benefits to include free uniform and laundry, employee achievement award, and gifts during Christmas and major anniversary celebration. What is missing here? The word gifts, regalo. Finally, the employee may be receiving a financial bonus under the law. The 13th month pay has to be paid by the employer to the employee. And the employer may exercise also its benevolence by giving an extra month called 14-month pay. Having looked at the gamut of fringe benefits that an employee can get, the next question is if we follow the principle that all benefits are taxable, the government issued an encouraging legislation saying that there are certain of these benefits just enumerated that are of small value, and so they were called de minimis. And when they fall within the concept of de minimis benefits, then government says, I will not enforce the tax on those benefits. So the de minimis benefits can be looked upon as facilities or privileges or courtesy discounts on purchases of relatively small value which the employer gives to his employee for their health and contentment to encourage their efficiency while fostering goodwill. I remember sentimentally that concept of courtesy discounts. In 1969, I joined the ESO Philippines, and among the leading divisions of ESO, among the leading products, is ESO Gasul. And ESO Gasul doesn't only have those, LPG in cylinders. We have also a line of gas ranges that were available for sale. And one of my high school classmates, Joe Contapay, was in the sales organization of Gasul in Pasig. And so my wife was excited to buy a gas range. And I knew we had an employee discount. And so when I went to, to ESO Gasul with my wife and met my classmate, Joe Contapay, he helped me choose the particular beautiful range that we will be buying, and we were given a substantial discount, almost like a dealer's price. And so these courtesy discounts are very beautiful manifestation of the care of the employee. So every time I go home and I see my wife using that to cook very nice meals for me, I looked at that Esso Gasol range and remember to love my company because my company cares for me. That is precisely what is meant by contentment. Encourage efficiency. Because we were managerial employees, magtatrabaho kami kumisan hanggang alas 11, alas 12 ng gabi. Ang tawag namin doon ay overtawad because walang bayad. But because my company showed me that he cares for me and my family, and I always remember him by that beautiful cooking range that he gave me, he sold to me at a discount. My efficiency, my desire to render much, much more, as we said, running the extra mile was encouraged. So the minimis benefits has a real economic value to the employer. And government says, because you are my partner, I will not also tax that particular de minimis benefits. Ganto po, ipuma. And so we will now enumerate the fringe benefits and identify what is the maximum amount of this benefit that is tax-free. To start the ball rolling again, let's go back to DIBS with pay. Remember, under the principle that no work, no pay, the employee is not in his workstation rendering service. He is somewhere else, like he's taking his vacation. The company will grant him pay. No? And let us take a look at some sample. In many companies, you know, while the labor code requires only 5 days of service incentive leave, that is the equivalent of vacation leave, only 5 days. Most companies, by industry practice and even covered by collective bargaining agreements, do extend 15 days minimum as vacation leave with pay. So for every year, on the first year, the employee works and earns the 15-day paid vacation leave. On the second year, he now says, boss, can I now avail of my 15-day vacation leave? And the supervisor says, go, and we file your application. So for the next 15 working days, the employee is not in his workstation as a productive member of the team. He is at home resting, you know, watching the latest upload on YouTube in terms of movies, and yet he gets his salary for 15 days. However, this particular leave with pay can have a modification in personality. What happens now if the employee did not avail of his leave with pay? He says, boss, there is so much to do here. If I leave, it will not only affect my output, it will also affect the output of my team, of our team. And so I will not take a leave. I will be working here even if I'm entitled to 15 days. So what does the employer say? Okay, if you did not use your leave on the second year that you earned on the first year, then at the end of the second year, I am giving you the privilege to convert whatever you should have received in vacation leave pay to cash. It's a cash conversion. Question. If he were to be given a cash conversion of his unused vacation leave, is that de minimis benefits? Government says, of 15 days, the first 10 days is de minimis benefits. You are paid for that in cash. We will not impose any tax on that one as de minimis benefits. But because you have 15 days and therefore you are paid 15 days, while the first 10 days is de minimis, the balance of 5 days is taxable income already. Taxable income. Okay? And we will handle that when we reach that portion of 13th month pay and other benefits, because conceptually, a worker or employee should now pay his tax. But we will show you in a little while that after the employee has to pay the 5-day conversion on sick on vacation leave. He may still have a balance of his 13-month and other benefits that he can use to shield the taxability of that 5-day vacation leave with pay. Mamaya natin pag-usapan ng kundi yan. But remember, we already brought it up initially here when we were discussing the minimis benefits. The second one is a modification in favor of the employee if the conversion to cash, which usually happens when the employee now, the government employee, retires from service and all of his accumulated but unused vacation leave is converted into what is called terminal leave pay. Babayaran siya na. Question, de minimis benefits ba yon? Ang sagot ng gobyerno, accumulation niya na yung leave, nagtatrabaho sa gobyerno, when we pay you your terminal leave in cash, which is the equivalent of the unused vacation leaves, lahat yan, tax-free. We will consider that as de minimis benefits. Now, before I move on, because it is not in this slide, if we speak about vacation leave, may kamag-anak ito kanina na sick leave. So when an employee, for example, gets sick, he may be at home resting or he may be in the hospital recuperating or being cured, and so he's not in his workstation. But the company says that if you get sick and you are not in your workstation, we will still pay you while you're on sick leave. Okay. So that's first scenario, no? Hindi siya nagtatrabaho, pinasweldo siya, under sick leave, 15 days, okay lang. Now, the next scenario is, malakas ang katawan niya, hindi siya nagkasakit. So, nagtrabaho siya all through the second year. Kasi you earn it on the first year, you develop it on the second year. Pagdating ng second year, sabi ng kumpanya, because you did not get sick as an incentive, I will convert to cash your sick leave. Ayun, may 15 days na naman siya. Hindi siya nagkasakit. Nakuha niya in cash. Question, will the government now consider the conversion of sick leave to cash a de minimis benefit? The answer is no. The conversion of sick leave to cash is not de minimis benefits and therefore the corresponding tax will be imposed. Again, I reserve the second level explanation that this taxable sick leave can be still shielded under the concept of 13-month and other benefits. Doon sa and other benefits that we will take up in a little while. The employee worker may also get some medical benefits to include medical cash allowance for the employee's dependents, for as long as it does not exceed 750 pesos per semester or 120 pesos per month. And the fourth one under under medical benefits would be those particular items considered as medical assistance, comprising of medical and healthcare needs, medical executive checkup, maternity assistance and routine consultations for as long as the total amount per year does not exceed 10,000 pesos, such medical assistance given to the worker by the employer is considered de minimis benefits. Continuing with de minimis benefits, an employee receiving additional financial compensation and assistance may be receiving the following. You're all familiar with this. We have a government-approved rice subsidy or the need to give rice to the employee per month amounting to 2,000 pesos per month for 12 months, that is 24,000 pesos. That is equivalent to 50 kilos per year. Again, 2,000 pesos rice is de minimis benefits, not subject to tax. The other one is very interesting because there are workers, there are employees who work under the program of three shifts for the whole day. In Motorola, a semiconductor company similar to the other semiconductor for companies, we have three shifts. The first shift, shift A, starts from 6 o'clock to 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Then they go home. The second shift, shift B, comes in at 2 o'clock up to 10 o'clock in the evening. 8 hours with a 1 hour break. So at 10 o'clock, they again go home. And so the third shift, shift C, comes in at 10 o'clock in the morning, in the evening, you know, and goes home at 6 o'clock in the morning. Another 8 hours with a 1 hour break. Under the law, if any worker now works from 10 o'clock to the morning, then that particular person is considered to be not only working overtime, but also deserving a night shift differential. May bayad yun, no? And nagtatrabaho nga siya, dadagdagan yung kanyang premium, may overtime siya, kung overtime na yun, kung lumampas na sa shift niya, at the same time, meron siyang differential na night or shift differential. Pero while he is in the workstation, eh, kailangan naman sigurong kumain siya, no? Either yung midnight snack or may breakfast siya. And what is given to him by way of the minimum benefits is a monthly computation, a daily meal allowance of 0.25%. Oo, so hindi 25% kundi 0.25% of his basic minimum wage. Kasi kung 25% yan, eh lalabas niyan for example, eh sa bawat 10 araw, eh 4 na araw ibabayad sa kanya. Hindi po ganun, kundi 0.25%. So this decimal should have been put there, and that will be his daily meal allowance times the number of days that he is working daily to it. Next, the employee may also be getting other benefits to include uniform and clothing allowance per year. And that is rounded to 6,000 pesos. And if the uniform, free uniform, and clothing allowance per year does not exceed 6,000, that is de minimis benefits not subject to tax. Of course, anything in excess of 6,000 becomes taxable fringe benefit. Next, because if you're giving him free uniform or free clothing allowance, obviously you don't want your worker to smell a little bad because of perspiration. You give him also a laundry allowance, whether he wants to launder himself or ask a lavandera to do it, he's given 300 pesos per month allowance. So 300 pesos times 12 months, that is 3,600. Again, de minimis benefits are subject to tax. The employee may also be receiving employees' achievement awards for the number of years that he has served the company, or a safety achievement award for taking care of the company premises and avoid any accidents along the way. And there can be compensatory awards given to it. Like for example, length of service, many companies would award their employees for loyalty and commitment after they have served for 5 years, for 10 years, for 20, 15 years, 20 years, or even longer. However, if they are given an award, Employees Achievement Award, the Achievement Award should not exceed 10,000 pesos during that year that it was given. And the award cannot be in cash. It has to be intangible personal property whose value does not exceed 10,000 pesos. And so it comes to pass that, for example, some companies may be awarding, for instance, a gold pin for 5 years, a wristwatch, no, for 10 years, and even probably some more expensive gifts as employees' achievement award, provided each award does not exceed 10,000 pesos and is given not in cash but in tangible personal property. Also, all employees should be treated equally in this Employees Achievement Award. And so it is possible that a janitor who has served the company for, say, 15 years would receive that particular watch, which is perhaps Seiko. But his boss, also serving 15 years as Vice President for Finance, no, cannot receive more than the value of a Seiko watch. He cannot be given a Rolex watch just because he is Vice President. Otherwise, if the Seiko watch has a value of, say, 3,000 pesos, and that is the entitlement of, that was what was given to the janitor when he deserves 10,000 pesos. And to his boss, he was given a Rolex watch worth probably 300,000 pesos. What will happen is the boss gets the Rolex watch for 300,000 pesos. What is only the minimis to him is 10,000. So he pays, you know, a fringe benefit, a tax on the fringe benefit of 300 minus 10,000, or he pays a tax of 290,000. So the minimis benefits of 10,000 is a standard for that particular situation for two employees, one a rank and file and the other one a senior executive. Likewise, if the employees are receiving gifts, you know, like a benevolent Christmas gift from the company, the employee will not be subjected to tax provided the gift does not exceed 5,000 pesos. Any gift during Christmas holidays or any major anniversary of the company will be de minimis benefits up to the extent of 5,000 pesos. Obviously, if the gift is more than 5,000 pesos, the excess will not be taxable fringe benefit. Other benefits that then come to the taxpayer employee will be, for example, the signing bonus in CBA signing and also some productivity incentive scheme, which is already mentioned here as safety achievement. That would be essentially also similar to the productive incentive bonus. So when the workers were to come into a consensus to sign the CBA, there may be a signing bonus, and the signing bonus is de minimis benefits up to only 10,000 pesos. So anything that is 10,000 or below is de minimis benefits are subject to tax. Anything in excess will be subjected to taxation. And now, the 13th month pay. The 13th month pay and other benefits is a catch-all. And so the maximum that an employee can avail of the 13th month pay and other benefits is 90,000. And so when an employee salary is only 20,000, he has an unavailed of other benefits of 70,000. And so this is where he can now use this buffer of 70,000 if he were, for example, in this case, given a uniform of equivalent of 10,000. Under the minimis benefits of uniform and clothing allowance of 6,000, if he were given 10,000, the difference, which is 10,000 minus 6,000, is 4,000. Normally taxable. Now he can invoke now that in the other benefits out of the buffer of 70,000, I will now be also invoking the 4,000 as chargeable to this one. Same is true, for example, with drawn B allowance of 300 per month. That is 3,600 per year. Binigyan siya ng laundry allowance na 500 per month, that is equivalent to 6,000 pesos against 3,000. The balance of 2,400 will also be available to be offset against the buffer of 7,000, and so on. And that is how the 13th month pay and other benefits come to work. To summarize now how the tax-free de minimis benefits would look like in the case of a rank and file employee. Let us take a look at what happens now. Let us say the employee now has a base pay of 50,000 pesos. That means in 12 months, he gets 600,000 pesos. And when we look at the fringe benefits given by the company, you have now there the vacation leave equivalent to 15 days, you know. And since we did not equate this 15 to the 15, we just simply pick up this one as a theoretical number. So he has 15 days, but the minimis benefits will allow only 10 days. So we will have a taxable fringe benefit of 5,000. The sick leave converted to cash is not a de minimis benefit, and therefore that will be included as taxable fringe benefit to him. And so on with the medical allowance, rice subsidy, and so on, which did not exceed the de minimis benefits maximum. And so if we were to summarize the effect of this one, the de minimis benefits in total amounted to 164,500, and he will only be asked to pay a tax of 20,000 pesos as taxable fringe benefit. However, you will notice that the 90,000 13-month pay and other benefits, he is only able to avail of 50,000, which means he has still a 40,000 unavailed of other benefits. To that 40,000, he can now use that 40,000 as a tax shield to his excess de minimis benefits, so that 20,000, you apply now the 40,000, there is even a buffer of another 20,000. There is no more any de minimis benefit that is taxable. This will be 20,000, and then a negative of 20,000 here that will now be offsetting and zero. And so he will be back to his net taxable income, not at 620, but only at 600,000, because his 20,000 was buffered by the unused 13th month pay and other benefits of 90 minus 50. So he is still 40,000 in buffer. And so we have covered the first group of fringe benefits that are not subject to tax taxation. The second grouping, where the government says, okay, I recognize that you have a fringe benefit, but this time the fringe benefit falls under the employer convenience rule, you will not be taxed on that one. So let us take a look at how this thing works. Under the employer convenience rule, it is accepted that the employee will receive a fringe benefit, you know, from the employer. But this employee's fringe benefit is not taxable when his employer gives the benefit for the employer's primary convenience. Take note, the employer is giving that particular fringe benefit to benefit him primarily, benefit the employer primarily, and incidentally, necessary for the employee to perform his duties properly. In effect, the structure is, here is a fringe benefit, and you are my employee, my worker, I'm giving this to you. And while you will benefit from this as a collateral benefit, in reality, my giving it to you will benefit me more than the benefit that I can see you are getting. That is the concept of the employer convenience rule. And so, if we now take some very illustrative examples, let us take a look at a driver of an obstetrician gynecologist. What is the nature of the obstetrician gynecologist? While this person, as a doctor, may be reporting to her clinic from 8 to 5, it is a reality that her patients, infanticipating patients, may be giving birth, you know, after 5 o'clock, and that means therefore she has to rush back to the hospital on that particular occasion, needing her medical services. And if therefore there is a call that a patient is now about to give birth, she needs to rush to the hospital, and therefore she needs a means of transportation. And so therefore, the driver here is told, Igme, pumasok ka nga mamaya at baka mamaya yung mga anak na si Mrs. Santos, for example. So pumasok si Igme. But that happens every now and then. So sabi ni Doktora, for example, Mary, Igme, mabuti pa siguro, bigyan na lang kita ng living quarter dyan sa tabi ng maid's quarter, may driver's quarter, at bibigyan na lang kita ng libreng pagkain during the time that you're staying here. Pwede mo nga isama yung pamilya mo eh. Normally, dapat magbabayad ka ng rental sa akin, magbabayad ka ng bills, pero I'm giving those as fringe benefits to you. Yung living quarter mo, for example, siguro worth 5,000, hindi na kita sisingilin. At yung meals mo siguro, another 5,000 per month, hindi na rin kita sisingilin. So sabi ni Igme na driver, ma'am, marami pong salamat. Sabihin ni Doktora Mary, sa totoo lang, while nakikinabang ka, mas malaki ang pakinabang ko kasi kung wala ka, hindi ako makakatakbo ng mabilis sa ospital para abutan ko yung mga anak. Eh syempre, yung mga anak magbabayad naman sa akin ng doctor's fees. Kaya kung titingnan mo, yung binibigay ko sa yung finished benefit under employer convenience rule, makakabuti sa'yo, pero sa akin, mas lalo makakabuti kasi kikita ako na hindi naman ako kikita kung wala ka para to help me go to the hospital. Okay. Ito, very celebrated case because this was also brought up by the members of the armed forces in the United States. Here, the officers and enlisted men are given by the Republic of the Philippines to the Armed Forces of the Philippines certain fringe benefits like barracks and living quarters, subsistence or food allowance, and uniform and clothing allowance. We are all aware that the work of a soldier is to be on standby for any call of duty. And so if therefore, he has to stay at the military camp, he has to be provided with living quarters and barracks for free so that when the exigency of calling them into field duty on a shooting war against the enemies of the state, then they are already on standby. And so the barracks and living quarters, while that is free, that can cost money, it is really given by the government, the armed forces, for its own convenience to assemble its troops as fast as it can so that it can respond to the emergency as needed. The same is true with subsistence and food allowance. If you do not give food or subsistence allowance to your soldiers while they're in barracks, then they will have no other means but to go out of the camp to look for food. Worse, when they are in actual field operations and they have no food allowances, this is where the temptation for them to get the chickens and the pigs and all the possible things that can be taken for their food and subsistence in the field of operations from among the, what they call this, citizenry. And that creates a very bad image and destroys the image of the soldier. Same is true with uniform and clothing allowance. Can you imagine an armed forces na kanya-kanya sila ng uniform? It is not only fostering discipline but in camaraderie, it is also setting up the kind of atmosphere that a respectable army or navy or air force deserves. And all of these fringe benefits are really benefiting the officers and enlisted men, not only of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, but also the Philippine National Police. But in reality, it is the Republic of the Philippines, through their employers AFP and PNP, who are really more than benefited by the convenience that is given them when these particular fringe benefits are made available under the employer convenience rule. Not taxable at that. The third one is, of course, a fish pond caretaker. These three instances were given in the bar examination and so were already tested among those who passed the bar examination. You have a fish pond caretaker because the fish pond owner operator, for example, in Bulacan, set up his fish farm. And so therefore, he built a certain nipa hut at the middle of the fish pond so that the fish pond caretaker will not only be there to watch over the fish against pilferage for 24 hours, but also to ensure that the fish are taken care of. That particular nipa hut may have a rental value, say, who knows, 4,000. And he will be provided with meals, no? Probably pati yung isda, pwede niyang kainin na libre. And all of these are fringe benefit to the fish pond caretaker. But they are not subject to tax because they benefit more the fish pond owner or operator as the primary convenience benefit in their favor. And so, to the employee fish pond caretaker, the monetary value of the living quarters and meals are not taxable under the employer convenience rule. And so, we have covered the two groups of fringe benefits that are not taxable insofar as the government is concerned. And the third group is what is called the fringe benefits tax. The fringe benefits tax is actually an income tax, which the employer pays in behalf of his managerial or supervisory employee for a fringe benefit furnished, granted, or paid to cover the employee's private use of that benefit. One particular example here that we can cite is that an employee has a car. And that particular car was given to him for use by the employer. And so the employee now has a free car. And that particular free car has a value. Say it's a Fortuner for 2 million pesos. And when the employer gives the employee the right to use it, the monetary value of 2 million pesos becomes the benefit to the user of that car. Otherwise, he would have to use his own money to buy that car. And so because it is a fringe benefit to him, it will be included in his taxable income and he will have to pay a tax on the 2 million car that he's using. Now, here is the catch. He says, "Boss, you gave me a car, true enough. But I have to pay a tax on that. And that means with this car, you are diminishing my take-home pay. Because I will have to get from my take-home pay to pay to the government the equivalent tax on this car as a fringe benefit. So instead of giving me a happy situation, my family, while looking at the beautiful Fortuner car, is wondering in turn why they have to reduce our meals just because you gave me a Fortuner car." So the employer says, "What do you want? Boss, can you now pay the tax for me?" And so the employer says, "Oh my God. So that means I'm giving you two fringe benefits. I gave you a car for 2 million. And on top of the 2 million, I also have to pay for your income tax, income tax on that fringe benefit." "Yes, sir." "Sir, if you do not want to give that to me, you can take back the car because I cannot afford to pay the tax on that one. And if that happens, I will continue to be late, I will be inefficient, and so on and so forth. I will not be in the same footing as all the other managers, supervisors, and vice presidents in our company. And although also other companies. To be candid about it, sir, our competitor on the next door is also offering me to transfer double my salary plus the car and they will pay for the fringe benefit. Oh, sige na, to be competitive, we will give you the 2 million Fortuner car and at the same time we will pay the fringe benefit that otherwise you should be paying. So you get two benefits. The fringe benefit itself that we are mentioning here and the income tax on that benefit that we will also be paying." That is the nature of a fringe benefits tax. it is a tax on the fringe benefit given. And these are usually extended to managerial or supervisory employees. The fringe benefits tax is the difference between the gross up fringe benefit, so that's 2 million for example, divided by 100% minus 35% or 65%, and the actual benefit granted. So it is the incremental, that would be the imputed fringe benefits tax that the employee should have paid on his account, but is asking the employer to shoulder that particular fringe that particular tax, which is called the fringe benefits tax. So the employer may be an individual, a professional partnership, a corporation, whether taxable or not. Take note, a non-taxable corporation will still be liable to pay on the fringe benefits tax, because the fringe benefits tax is not his obligation to be covered by non-taxability. It is the obligation of his employee receiving that taxable fringe benefit, and he is paying the tax thereof. So when the corporation employer corporation pays on the fringe benefits tax, it is not paying in his behalf. It is paying on a taxable employee. And so even when the corporation is a tax-free corporation, he has to still pay the fringe benefits tax in behalf of the managerial employee for whom he's paying the tax. And so this is not also exempting the government or its instrumentality. So if you have a government agency or even a government corporation that gives these kinds of fringe benefits, subject to tax, the payment of the fringe benefits tax is equally demandable even from government instrumentalities, agencies, or government-owned or controlled corporations. Examples of these benefits, we already mentioned one, the car plan or vehicle plan, foreign travel and the expenses related thereto, holiday and vacation expenses, housing, household personnel, maids, cooks, drivers, gardeners, expense accounts, membership fees, dues, and expenses in social and athletic clubs or other similar organizations, life or health insurance or other non-life insurance premiums in excess of what the law allows, educational assistance to the employee or his dependents, and interest on loans. If I may revisit membership dues, fees, and expenses, the fringe benefits tax covers memberships on social and athletic clubs. That means, therefore, when normally an employee joins a club, more like for example a health club, then that particular athletic or health club is a personal benefit type. And so when there is a membership fee that is collected or membership dues monthly, then when normally the employee should pay for that because that is for his personal benefit. But when the employer pays for that, then it becomes a fringe benefit subject to fringe benefits tax. The exception to this is that membership in professional and similarly related organizations. So for purposes of, for example, given an example, if the employee is a member of the Philippine Bar, and there is a need for that particular employee to pay certain dues to the Integrated Bar of the Philippines or to spend money on the minimum corporate, the mandatory continuing legal education, MCLE. These fees are necessary in the exercise of their profession servicing the organization. The payment of these membership fees would constitute business expense rather than fringe benefit. The same can be mentioned, for example, of CPAs, where they have to be members of Philippine Institute of CPAs, and then also to attend seminars and membership meetings on a monthly basis. They are all they may be paid by the company and they will not be subject to tax but fully deductible as business expense. To illustrate, for instance, the fringe benefit tax in a car plan structure. First, the fringe benefits tax is due whether the vehicle is used partly to benefit the employer and for the employee's personal benefit. That should be employees, not employees' personal benefit. Vehicles for sales, freight, delivery service, and other non-personal use are not considered as fringe benefits but business expenses. In effect, from the vice president for marketing and sales up to the lowest salesman of a company, if they are provided with company cars for sales purposes, then those cars are not considered as fringe benefits because, in effect, that is the major mechanism by which the sales can perform their function. And so whatever is the original cost or value of those vehicles will be charged as business expenses. Obviously, if the delivery van is for freight, no? Freight in, delivery service, freight out, and other non-personal use, they would not be fringe benefits to anybody because they are actually business expenses to service the needs of the employer. Cars considered fringe benefits are under the employee's name, usually to be subjected to the fringe benefits tax. The car, the vehicle, would be in the name of the employee. This is a caveat for tax planning and implementation purposes. While there is a provision on a company fleet of cars where these are divided equally among those who are using the company fleet, there is a gray area here when the employee buys his own car. He buys his own car. And therefore, it is his personal expense. But the company decided, for example, to give him an allowance that would be representing either the installment of his car or the, in effect, the straight line depreciation of his car, which he uses both for personal or company. And therefore, the reimbursement to him will no longer be made to appear as a fringe benefit. It will simply be charged as business expense, and it will be very tedious for the BIR to trace these individual cars. That is a means of tax avoidance bordering on tax evasion, because in reality, they would be fringe benefits given to those employees. Fringe benefits grossed up rates. Examples of a regular managerial employee and a non-resident alien employee not in trade or business. The gross-up factor is 35% under the train law. And let us assume certain acquisition costs of $2 million of a brand new Fortuner, which is also perhaps the cash that is given to the employee. If the employee were to buy the car and put it in his name, he borrows the $2 million. And then the installment or rental payment of $57,500. Now, the option would be the employer buys the Fortuner for cash, or the employers give to cash also of the same amount to the employee. In whatever way it is, the $2 million acquisition cost of the Fortuner will now be divided by 100% minus 35%. To determine the fringe benefit and the related tax. And here the computation shows $3,076,923 with a $2 million fringe benefit, and the differential of $1,076,923 becomes the equivalent tax thereon. What if the employee buys on installment? It will be acquisition cost minus interest. And if the amount is $57,500, times 5 years and 12 months, you have now the corresponding computations of the same 3,076,923. And so with this, ladies and gentlemen, we have covered the concept of active incomes, particularly under the employer-employee relationship. And we said the fringe benefits are normally all subject to tax, except three groupings: the minimus benefits, benefits under the employer convenience rule, and fringe benefits tax. All of the three, not included in the taxable active fringe benefit of the employee. Having seen the employer-employee structure, let us now enumerate in turn who are the professionals who are also deriving active income from the exercise. And so here, the income from the practice of the profession or trade would include the following professions. And we know the difference is that for those categorized as professionals, they're supposed to be carrying a certain field of expertise that was already tested as validly possessed by them in terms of a qualifying governmental examination administered by, for lawyers, the Supreme Court of the Philippines, and for other professions, the Professional Regulations Commission. So here are some of the professions: the lawyers, they derive an active income of attorney's fees; the medical doctor, consultation fees; CPA, audit fees; engineer, professional fees; as well as architects and consultants are consultant fees, and agents are agents' commission. There are certain talented individuals who also earn income even when they have not, they are not required to pass any qualifying examination by the government. To include singers like Martin Rivera, who gets paid for his talent fee; musician like Mr. Ocampo, who helps out si Martin Rivera, contract fee; actors and actresses, obviously si Coco Martin in and Yasi Freshman in Provinciano; dance instructor and instructress; electrician who gets service fee; welder service fee; and masseur service fee. So these groups of professionals and talented people would be the second category of those earning active incomes, and they would equally be subject to tax on their active incomes. We will leave the third category on active income in business as we discuss the concept of business side by side with deductions on the forthcoming upload. It is now about time for us to go to the second kind of gross income. From active income, we move to passive income. And some of the highlights on passive incomes would include the very concept of passive income. Again, let us emphasize that in the case of passive incomes, the income earned by the taxpayer as fruits of his property, like cash, properties, and other financially valuable resources, is not the result of the actual direct and personal effort of the taxpayer. It is actually the fruits paid for the properties that he allows other people to use. And so it is the properties like cash, property, and other finance that is really directly earning the income. And because they are the fruits of those properties and the properties belong to the owner, the supposed fruits become the property also of the owner, and that is what is called passive income in favor of the now, very significant feature of passive incomes is that the final withholding tax at source is implemented by whoever is paying the passive income. And so, for example, if it is money that is lent out and interest is paid on that, conceptually, the one paying the interest is to become the withholding agent of the government in order for that withholding agent to directly remit to the BIR. In effect, the payment of the passive income to the owner of the property being used is no longer the gross, but the net after withholding tax. So passive incomes are subject to final withholding tax at source, and as a consequence, these passive incomes are excluded. Let's repeat, excluded from the income tax return because the final withholding tax has already been withheld and paid. Let us now run through some of the properties that taxpayers use in order to earn their passive income. Well, for example, an individual has cash savings and he decides to lend that to the government as a depositor in a bank deposit structure such as savings account or time deposit. Obviously, the money placed with the bank earns interest income as fruits. And the interest income as fruits of the bank deposit made by the owner of the cash becomes his passive income, subject to withholding tax. However, the interest on bank deposits may be too low. Our friend here, in using his cash, may engage into private transactions involving mutuum or loan, or he can lend corporations by way of subscribing to bonds. Again, the target is to earn interest income, and when he is to be paid his passive interest income, the creditor here would withhold the final withholding tax. And so what goes to the taxpayer on his passive income would only be the net after withholding tax. So moving to the third example, that particular individual has cash savings. It may decide to just participate in the ownership of corporations by buying their shares of stocks like San Miguel, Petron, you know, BDO, SM, what have you. And therefore, his source of income arising from his placement of cash in shares of stocks is to await for the declaration of cash dividends. And finally, he may be too lazy to get involved with this. He brings his entire 10 million at the casino and puts his gambling bet. His cash is now on the table. And if he wins, for example, then he has winnings and prizes, his passive income. Of course, if he loses, he will have his passive loss. Okay, next. That person may use his cash to buy real and personal properties such as land, buildings, equipment, vehicles. And he can allow other people under a contract of lease to use those particular properties of his, and therefore the properties derive fruits in the form of rental income if there were leases. On the other hand, that particular person may buy and sell land, buildings, equipment, and vehicles. And under normal conditions, you can either get a capital gains or a capital loss subject to capital gains tax in the case of capital gains. The person may have purchased or developed on his own inventions and all the natures of intellectual properties like copyrights, patents, and so on, where he derives royalties and all of these things. These are types of passive incomes that can be earned. Now, let us finally touch on capital gains and losses. A capital gain is essentially an income tax. It is just given a special title because the capital gains bring about the need to understand what is called capital assets. If you look at an asset, essentially, you can either look at an asset from two angles. And therefore, if you sell an ordinary asset, then the gain from the sale of ordinary asset is an ordinary gain. On the other hand, if the asset is categorized as capital asset, the profits of selling the capital asset is what brings about capital gains. So it is very easy. You sell a capital asset for profit, the profit or gain is supposed to be an ordinary gain. If you sell a capital asset and you made profits or income, then the income there is called capital gains. So the key to understanding ordinary versus capital gains and losses is to be able to identify what are ordinary assets versus capital assets. And it's also very easy. If they are ordinary assets, they're not capital assets. So generally, if you look at the universe of your assets, those assets are ordinary assets if they are intended to be sold in the ordinary course of business. And there are two categories under this. What are called the stocks in trade or inventories, which would represent, for example, the goods, movable goods, that are put on display for retail selling in supermarkets, department stores, you know, sari-sari stores, whatever you. Anything that is supposed to be purchased at a lower price and sold at a higher price to make money. And they are part of the regular products that you position in the outlets. They are called inventories or stocks in trade for sale, and they fall within the category of ordinary assets. Now, in the same light, the property that you are selling, buying and selling, may not be movable properties. They may not be canned goods, they may not be garments, they may not be shoes, they may not be, for example, computer equipment, you know. They may actually be land and buildings. They are real or immovable properties for sale. And this is where, you know, those engaged in what they call real estate business would come into the picture. For instance, in the case of DMCI, in the case of SMDC, in the case of Mega World, where they build, for example, buildings, and within the buildings, they have, of course, the condos, and they start selling them. The inventory that they're involved in are non-movable, immovable. And because the intention is to sell them, even when they are immovable properties, they will still comprise saleable items and therefore ordinary assets. So ordinary assets for sale will be movable stocks in trade or inventories and immovable properties intended to be sold in the ordinary course of business. So yan, binibenta. Binibili, binibenta, yung isa movable, yung isa immovable. Now, the next category of ordinary assets is those assets are not intended for sale. And so you look at the organization, look at the corporation, and you look at those assets that the corporation is using for its business. So they are the second category of ordinary assets, where the assets are used in the ordinary course of business. And there are two groupings, no? Similar also to the two groupings here. The first grouping are depreciable properties, meaning those properties that get to literally be subjected to wear and tear. And that will include buildings, machinery, and furniture. That these buildings are not intended for sale, unlike the one on the first category. They're intended to be used as shelter of the factory, as a site of their offices. The machinery are obviously those that are used to produce the product where they're involved in. And so this is the first category of ordinary assets used in ordinary course of business. And the other one is very simple, the land, real properties used in business, the site where the building or the factory is situated. So on these two categories, you have another group of ordinary assets that are used in the ordinary course of business. So again, to summarize, there are two types of ordinary assets. the ordinary assets that are intended for sale in the ordinary course of business, and the ordinary assets that are used in the business of the taxpayer. If we now therefore move on capital gains, again, we can only distinguish capital gains and losses if we can go back to where the gains and losses come from, and so we look at capital assets. On the first area, we have ordinary assets. If the capital, if the asset is for you for sale or for use, they are ordinary assets. But if, as you looked at the asset is not for sale, or it is not for use in business, then that is when you consider them capital assets. And there are two very simple enumeration: investment in shares of stocks and bonds. You take note, a while ago we said in the area of cash investment, the person who has the money to earn passive income may decide, no, to buy shares of stocks with San Miguel, Petron, BDO, SM, what have you. Now, the purchase of these particular stocks and bonds is an option to earn the passive income of dividends. But the shares of stocks from which the dividend income will come from are considered capital assets. Those capital stock subscription or bond subscription, they are the principal to generate the dividend income or interest income. So this particular capital representing cash that were used to buy the stocks and bonds would be capital asset. Why? Because when you have these stocks and bonds, unless you are in the business of stock trading, normally you do not intend to sell or you do not intend to use these particular stocks because they are there for you to generate the passive income of dividends and interest income. Now, the easier one is when you go to residential property. Obviously, the place where you live is not intended for sale and it is not intended for business. And finally, idle lands are not intended for use in business. And because they're idle, probably they have no commercial value yet, or the commercial value limits its market price. And so they are not also for sale. So now that is also considered a capital asset. By way of updating ourselves on the rates in train law, when the shares of stocks are not traded in the stock market, no, but because there are stocks purchased can either be traded in the stock market, and that is subject to the usual tax, and those that are not traded in the stock market would be subject to this capital gains tax. The capital gains tax for stocks sold but not traded in the stock market would be 15% of the net capital gains for both individuals and domestic corporations. Only take note, when it is the stock of a domestic corporation being sold by another domestic corporation, that particular sale is not subject to tax. Okay. Second, capital gains on residential or idle lands. Again, you go back to this, to the traditional 6% of the gross selling price or fair market value at the time of sale of the residential lot in idle lands. However, we have an additional clarification on the sale of residential properties that may not be subjected to capital gains. So this is where you get now your 6% taxability on market price for selling residential lots. However, in addition to the gross selling 6% capital gains tax, you also need to pay the 1.5% documentary stamp tax. That's why most people think that selling land would incur, you know, capital gains of 7.5%. That is misleading. The 7.5% is the total of the 6% capital gains tax plus the 1.5% documentary stamp tax. Now, let us revisit now the capital gains on sale of residence tax being exempt. In here, you will see, ladies and gentlemen, a major aspect of a tax feature that benefits the organization, the individual taxpayer. When there is a sale of a residential property, the presumed capital gains from sale or disposition of principal residence are exempt. Take note, emphasize, exempt from the 6% capital gains tax, provided the five elements are present. Number one, the sales proceeds are fully utilized to acquire or construct a new residence. So you sold your property in Sampaloc for 5 million. The presumption is you will buy another property or construct another property in Parañaque using that 5 million proceeds. It's the first assumption. The second assumption, the acquisition or construction is done within 18 months from the date of sale of the Sampaloc property. Third, the historical cost of real property sold shall be carried over as the cost of the new residence for subsequent capital gains tax purposes, regardless of the actual cost of purchase or construction. This requires a little clarificatory explanation. Let us go back, for example, to your property in Sampaloc that you sold for 5 million. But when you build that property, it costs you only 2 million. And so you have theoretically a capital gains of 3 million. But you are not being imposed a tax on the 3 million or the 5 million gross selling price, 6% capital gains. No, you are given a tax exemption on that one. However, if you were to use the 5 million as proceeds from the sale of the Sampaloc property to buy another property in Parañaque, and you paid, for example, also 5 million, your property in Parañaque will not be valued at 5 million. Neither will it be valued at, it will be now valued at 2 million, as if it were the property that you owned in Sampaloc. What is the purpose? When you finally sell the property in Parañaque, it will not be gross selling, it will not be the computation of the gross selling price minus the actual cost of that property. The historical cost that will be used will be the property in Sampaloc. To my mind, this is moot and academic, because when you sell the property, you always slap it with the 6% on the gross selling price. You really do not compute the differential in capital to derive capital gains, because the capital gains tax is not imposed on the profit. It is imposed on the gross selling price at 6%. That is the reason why number three becomes a more of a theoretical concept, and it was not updated, because the original concept of capital gains is gross selling price minus acquisition cost. So that here, if you use an acquisition cost of 5 million and you sell the property for 8 million, then you have a capital gains of 8 minus 5 is 3. But here it is saying that if you're selling it at 8, you do not use 5 million as the acquisition cost of the Parañaque property, but you use the acquisition cost, not selling price, acquisition cost of the Sampaloc property, which exposes you to 8 million selling price of the Parañaque property minus 2 million, no? Assigned historical cost of your Parañaque property, which is coming from your historical cost of the Sampaloc property. So 8 minus 2 is 6 million capital gains taxable. That is irrelevant now, because under the rules, the capital gains tax now is a slap at a straight 6% of the gross selling price. So if you sell the Parañaque property at 8 million, you get slapped for 6% of 8 million, and nothing to do in the exercise of selling price minus historical cost becomes irrelevant. Number four, when the sales proceeds were not fully utilized, the excess shall be subject to the 6% capital gains tax. So, if you sold the Sampaloc property for 5 million and you bought a smaller property in Parañaque at 4 million, the unutilized 1 million will be subjected to the 6% capital gains tax. And this exemption from capital gains taxation can only be availed of every 10 years. So you can sell your residential lot every year, but you will only get the benefit of the capital and the exemption on capital gains every 10 years. All the other sale would be subjected to the usual capital gains tax of 6%. And so, ladies and gentlemen, this allowed us therefore to already take a look at the content of gross income divided into active income and passive income. And if we go back now, therefore, to our original slides, what remains to be done now is to consider the exclusions from gross income. And we will now wind up this presentation with these exclusions. So there are certain items that are not really included in gross income, other than what we talked about as the minimis benefits, fringe benefits arising from an employer-employee relationship, or the fringe benefits tax. This time, by the very nature of this money flowing to the tax to the individual, they are excluded from gross income. The first of these exclusions have something to do or related with sovereignty. In sovereignty, we looked at two components of sovereignty: international relations and internal sovereignty. So, the first exclusion arising from internal relations would be income from investment by foreign governments. Here, the hypothesis from a political law point of view is that one government cannot be more sovereign than the other, and therefore subject that government into taxation. So that means if the government of Singapore were to purchase, for example, shares of stocks of San Miguel Corporation and would earn income out of it, theoretically, the income, the dividends income of Singapore would be excluded from the taxability of Singapore as a foreign government. Now, the second category of exclusion is income exempt under treaty. Now here, there are certain international agencies that by treaty and by international practice are exempted. For example, all activities related to the United Nations, or for example, to the Asian Development Bank, or to, for example, the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development by treaty are not to be included in taxable gross income. There is also such a thing as an inter-country mutual tax agreement, in that both countries can sign an agreement that any tax paid by a taxpayer in other country will be entitled as a tax credit in the second country. The third exclusion are income by the government or its political subdivisions. This is a very practical consideration because when government is trying to raise funds to fund its services to the public, there is no reason why when the government generates money by way of governance and its political activity to supervise the people, to tax them would be like a financial self-masturbation, if I may be excused to say that. And so by way of basic national policy, we said that any income by the government or its political subdivision should be excluded from gross income taxation. Third one, income from essential government function. Like, for example, in the area of registration of motor vehicles when you collect. Or, for example, when you file a case in court and you are to be paying, for example, the filing fees. Then all of this in the performance of either an executive, administrative, or judicial functions would not be really subject to tax. And income from public utilities is another example of exclusions from gross income. There are certain government fiscal incentives that excludes certain items of supposedly income. There are two here that are listed: prizes and awards in sports competitions, provided that the competition was entered into by the athlete that received the prizes and awards sponsored by the National Sports Association where they belong to. Conceptually, for example, in the case of basketball, well, you have your PBA, Philippine Basketball Association, which appears to be also the legitimate organization recognized by the Philippine Olympic Committee to represent basketball. The same is true with boxing, the Philippine Boxing Association, the Philippine Volleyball Association, all of this. Now, here is a very interesting question. What if a person engages in sports that are outside of the influence of the sports association? Then the answer is the prizes and awards in such sports competition are subject to tax. So theoretically, when Manny Pacquiao fights a professional fight, he's no longer under the Philippine Boxing Association. He is a professional boxer. And so conceptually, he will be subjected to income tax under Philippine law. There is just one particular thing that I will not be touching on. If there is a tax treaty between the United States and the Philippines, then there can be implications that if Manny Pacquiao already paid his tax on his fee in fighting a boxing bout, the Philippines may already have signed a tax treaty with the United States where any amounts already paid in the U.S. by way of taxes is automatically recognized as for crediting under Philippine law. So money may not be suffering from double taxation. The second category of government fiscal incentives are prizes and awards for achievement in religious, charitable, scientific, educational, artistic, literary, and civic activities. On one particular reservation or provision, that these particular prizes and awards will not be subjected to tax, excluded from gross income, for as long as the awardee did not seek the award himself, meaning there was no effort on his part to apply to win the award. If that particular person in fact submitted an application for the award, if the subsequent award is given to him and it has a monetary value, the monetary value is subject to tax. Take note, there has to be no effort on the part of the awardee to apply for the award. If he did, then he will be subjected to taxation if he receives the award. Third, gains from sale of bonds, debentures, or certificates of indebtedness maturing in more than 5 years. So if you have, for example, subscribed to certain placements, time deposits, and bonds and debentures, and you sold that particular debenture after a holding period of 5 years, the gain from the sale, purchase price versus the selling price, is no longer subject to tax. And this is the reason why the banks are very naughty and very smart. When you look at their quotations on interest yields, they have already computed the interest yield on the sixth year. And so on the sixth year, suddenly, the yields of their certificates of indebtedness will jack up. That is not really out of the effort of the bank, but simply by waiting for the grace period of 5 years where the tax is no longer, the sale of the certificate of indebtedness is no longer subject to tax. government fiscal incentives, gains from redemption of investment in stocks of mutual funds. The mutual funds have been very popular in converting the insurance companies into mutual fund financial instruments. Next, compensatory reimbursement. These are supposed to be monies coming to the individual, but they do not represent gains. They are simply reimbursements to compensate for whatever losses they suffered. Included would be proceeds of life insurance to heirs and beneficiaries, and then return of premiums to the insured and compensation for injuries or sickness. Those exclusions under the employer-employee relationship, retirement benefits, pensions, and gratuities, the 13th month pay and other benefits, partly already discussed, and GSIS, SSS, PhilHealth, and labor union dues are not excluded from taxation. If we looked at the proceeds of life insurance to heirs and beneficiaries, for example, these are some of the guidelines on taxability of life insurance. The proceeds of life insurance paid to irrevocable heirs or beneficiaries are excluded from gross income and exempt from taxation. Let me now give a qualification. Under the present guidelines of the Insurance Commission, the pro forma of all life insurance policies contain an irrevocable heir provision. So which means that without doing anything, when the insured party signs his insurance policy, then should he perish, should he die, then the proceeds of his life insurance will not be taxable to his designated heirs, provided he did not modify the irrevocable feature of that particular thing. However, it allows him to ask the insurance company to insert a rider to convert the irrevocability of his heirs to a revocable provision. And so number two, the proceeds of a life insurance policy payable to a revocable beneficiary forms part of the decedent's gross estate whether or not the insured exercised revocation. Very, very important twist of application. So originally, the insurance policy has a provision that the heirs are irrevocable. Second, the insured party demanded from the insurance company to insert a rider or an amendment changing the irrevocable nature of his policy into a revocable one. And so the beneficiary nominated in that amended revocable life insurance policy is now in effect the subject matter of a potential revocation and replacement. Now, however, when the insured party dies and failed to exercise the revocable feature of that particular insurance policy, what will happen is that it is not in income tax where the effect would be. The proceeds of life insurance now will enter the arena of estate taxation. So that when the estate, with the net taxable estate of the decedent is computed, included in the gross estate is the proceeds of life insurance of a revocable policy. And so if the insured has an insured value of 10 million, that 10 million normally not subject to tax if there is the irrevocable heir becomes suddenly taxable by including it in the gross estate in computing his estate tax. And so the 10 million now will be subjected, assuming there are no other deductions, entitlement, that particular gross estate, which is probably the only property he has, assuming it's only property, the 10 million now will be subjected to 6% estate tax under the new train law. And so the proceeds of the insurance policy going to the revocable beneficiary will now be reduced by 6%. No, the 10% of 10 million is 1 million, that's 600,000. So the beneficiary will get 9,600,000. 9,400,000, while the 600,000, 6% capital gains will now go, not capital gains, I stand corrected. The 6% estate tax will now go to the government. So that's the distinction. Irrevocable policy, 10 million goes to the irrevocable heir. No? Revocable policy, even if there was no revocation, will now allow the government to include in the taxable decedent's estate 10 million and subject it to the 6% estate tax. And so the proceeds goes down now from 10 million only to 9,400,000. Very, very important variation under this particular guideline. What about the premium on life insurance? Premiums for life insurance on a key officer with his family as beneficiary are deductible expense, business expense, when said family members are not so related with the corporation as to make the corporation the indirect beneficiary. So that a key executive, president, vice president, and so on, and the corporation insured this particular individual and the beneficiary, it would be his wife and children, the corresponding premiums paid on that life insurance is deductible as business expense. However, if the corporation is a family corporation and the members of the family are actively involved, as more members of the board of directors and so on, and they are also the beneficiaries of the life insurance policy paid for by the corporation, then ultimately, if they get the proceeds of the insurance policy in their favor, but they're part of the organization, the prima facie presumption is they will invest further their proceeds into the corporation so that the corporation, in effect, cannot deduct the premium that is being paid because it is the beneficiary itself of the so-called insurance policy. Continuing, premium payments are additional compensation to the key officer to be part of his taxable gross income unless the employer pays the related fringe benefits tax. I think this is already very obvious. Now, another topic that is interesting on exclusion is the issue of compensation for injuries or sickness. Here, the philosophy is compensation for injuries or sickness is not income. And so amounts received through accident or health insurance or under Workmen's Compensation Act as compensation for personal injuries or sickness plus the amount of any job received whether by suit or agreement. Take note, there is an amicable settlement. No? Such injuries or sickness shall not be included in gross income because they are simply not gains. They are not income. They are really reimbursement of the injury or sickness, even if that was settled by way of an amicable settlement. Next, retirement benefits and pensions. Before we go to retirement benefits and pensions, let's go to the 13-month pay and other benefits. Well, we still went into the retirement benefits and pensions. Let's talk about involuntary separation benefits. I already mentioned this a while ago on the issue of vacation leaves converted to cash. In the case of accumulated vacation, and this time sick leave credits of an employee who separated involuntarily, the terminal leave pay, which is part of a tax-exempt separation pay, is likewise exempt. So, if the employee was terminated without his consent. Then, whatever accumulated vacation leave and sick leaves given to him in cash will be excluded from taxation. Now, the philosophy here is, even in the case of retirement, they say that retirement is involuntary because a person cannot do anything to change his birthday so that he becomes retirable without his choice when he reaches his retirement age. In the case of 13-month pay, or the reason why this is included is the discussion on 13-month pay is included here. And we now say that in the case of 13-month pay, the 13th month pay bonus and other benefits in excess of 90,000 is taxable, in excess of 90,000. Normal tax coverage applies because separation is or did not bring about the receipt of the 13th month pay. In other words, 13th month pay becomes still subject to the limitation of free for the first 90,000 and taxable in excess of 90,000. Because regardless of whether or not the employee is separated, he would still be getting his 13 months pay. With this, it looks like we have already covered almost all of the items we would like to cover in this particular area. And so therefore, we'd like to terminate this discussion and say that this is our first part of our presentation for purposes of gross income taxation. So in closing for this segment of income taxation on gross income, let me again reiterate that the subject matter of income taxation is, as a general rule, 60% of the questions in the bar examination on taxation. And out of that 60%, my estimate is about, 60%, that is 6 times 6 is 36%, would be coming from gross income. And you will notice that the discussion of gross income is really extensive. In closing, allow me again to say a little silent prayer for two people that I have come to love, not only professionally, not only as a student, but personally as friends. I will never forget Congressman Cirilo Roy G. Montejo as my first professor in taxation. And while he did teach us the rudiments of taxation when we were his students, what is even more interesting is Cirilo J. Montejo somehow impressed upon us the value of friendship by trying to remember the people whom we get in touch with. I recall on the first meeting when he announced the basis of his grading system. While he said that we will be graded according to our performance, obviously in the exams, in our attendance, recitation, and things like this, there is one aspect of recitation that he made a special reservation. He said that when he calls us on a recitation, he may or may not ask about the lesson assigned for the day. Because he reserved the right to ask a special question on our remembering the names of our seatmate on the left and on the right. And he said, it is very important for you to develop at this stage of your life when you are already mid-college, to remember the people that you meet here in college. You will never know when you will meet them again, either because you need help from them or you need their help, or just for purposes of reminiscing these days when you were in school. And so he said, I reserve the right to call you and reserve equally the right to ask you a different question of you reciting the name of your seatmate on the right and on the left. And so it came to pass that we started our lesson, talk about taxation, talk about lifeblood of the nation, etc. Then we went into income tax and so on. And he was calling recitations, you know, about the lessons. It came to pass that after a couple of weeks in his class, he did raffle the class cards to pick up Bisquera Joe-Santos. And normally, I sit on the front row on the extreme left beside the window. And so I have no seatmate on the left. I have only one seatmate on the right. And therefore, to me, it dawned on me that if this professor were to implement that secret policy or exception policy on me, I will have an advantage of naming only one. And so I was smiling. And true enough, when he asked me, when I stood up to answer the call of recitation, he said, you remember our policy on recitation, Mr. Bisquera? And I said, yes, sir. That I'm supposed to answer on the question that is subject matter of the meeting. But you remember the reservation I made? He said, what about, sir? Remember I said that I reserve the right to ask you a different question where you will be asked the name of your seatmate on the left and on the right. And the entire class was laughing. Well, because I will be the first victim of this guideline. The lucky break is as I'm making fun of the whole thing, I looked at the window and the wall to emphasize I don't have a neighbor seatmate on the left. And I looked at my seatmate, who is a good friend of mine, Albert Chan. And of course, I know Albert Chan. I know he comes from Lourdes School and so on and so forth, that is fond of cars, that is private business, is buy and sell cars. And so I said, yes, sir. And he also smiled because he recognized that I will not be caught in that kind of crossfire because I have only one seatmate on my right. And so I said, sir, to satisfy that particular question of yours on me naming my neighbor on the left and my neighbor on the right, allow me now to answer my recitation by saying, I have no neighbor on my left, and my neighbor on my right is Mr. Albert Cham from Banaue, Quezon City, a graduate of Lourdes School, engaged in the business of buying and selling cars. And everybody had a nice clap because they said, wow, lusot si Bisquera. But before he could give a grade of flat one in my favor with a smile, I said, sir, may I ask a favor to improve further my performance in recitation? What is that? He said, Mr. Bisquera. Sir, can I ask a favor to start naming the names of my classmates from the first seat on the first row up to Albert Cham, second seat, the second row, first seat up to the person behind me, third seat, and then some of those who are sitting at the fourth seat. And I will try to remember their names. And, part of his good nature, Congressman Montejo looked at me with a smile and said, can you do that? Can we also have a second bet that you will have a second grade in recitation? And if you miss one of your classmates, he said, I will give you a grade of 5 for volunteering. And I said, I will try, sir. And so I started, for example, number one is, I said, Mr. Victor Abella from Mauban, Quezon. The second is, for example, Miss Nelly Espino from Sampaloc, Manila. The third is Jose Guevara Jr., not the columnist, but one who comes from Masantol, Pampanga. And so everybody was looking at me because they were saying, don't miss me, you know. And after a couple of efforts, I was able to reach the last person at the back. And obviously, I got the biggest clap among my classmates. Professor Montejo did not realize I was running to be the vice president of the CUE student government in a popular election. And I was not considered a serious candidate because I never had a fraternity or a sorority. And so therefore, I had no solid vote. What many in the campus politics did not know is that since first year, first semester, I was already memorizing the names of my classmates, every subject, because they are the only means by which I can assure that I will get a vote. And so many of them said when the election was announced, Joe, takbo ka, sabi sa akin. And so, basta iboboto ka namin. And I talked to all of them, remembering their first and last name in their province, and I said, ayokong iboto nyo. Do not vote for me. Please, campaign so you carry four names in addition to your name. And so you have five names, and if you can list down those five names in a piece of paper and give it to me, and make sure that they cast their votes. That is the reason why I memorized my classmates in taxation, and therefore Congressman Montejo's methodology simply complemented my desire to remember by sincere interest the names of my classmates. Even today, my capacity to remember names among my students is a thing that I purposely develop. When I was teaching for 35 years at La Salle, I promised my students, if you were in my class, I will memorize your names, first and last names, on the third meeting, and I will set aside my class card. And if I meet you anywhere else, in the campus, in Manila, in the Philippines, even outside of the Philippines, I will call you by your first name and your last name. And if I fail, I owe you a free lunch or dinner. Unfortunately, my blood is Ilocano at Curipot, so I try to remember names up to now. And so, ladies and gentlemen, that is how I remember Congressman Cirilo Roy G. Montejo. Attorney Macario Perez will always impress me as the professor that simplified the diagram on succession. And as I go through all of the years where I need to resurrect my knowledge about succession, it will always be Macario Perez that will remind me. So with this, I'd like to thank you very much for allowing me to share with you these moments. This may not be the longest, neither is it the shortest lecture. Again, I beg you, watch for it. If you see anything abnormal about this or any clarificatory questions, you have the opportunity to put your comments, and I promise you I will respond. And I do respond to comments and questions. But in closing, allow me then, of course, to encourage you to click that particular little icon there on subscribe to allow me to somehow reach my target of 1,000 subscribers. I'm still down below 500 even after about 5 months. So I'm running low. Thank you very much for your opportunity that you gave me. I love you all.